Hachette Audio presents Jane 2, a novel, written and read by Sean Patrick Flanery.
For her, I believe there are only ever a handful of moments in a child's life that truly shape who he is or who he is to become. There are plenty of moments for fine-tuning, but only a handful that mold the sharp, memorable features of the face and also the soul. This is my handful. Chapter 1. So, here we are again. You know, most people check their mailbox to see what's inside it. But I think you know that I check mine to see what's not. I would tell you to stop me if you think that you've heard this one before, but I already know you've heard it before. Bear with me. Sometimes I just need to hear myself say it again, to get it out. I went home to try and touch the things I left behind. But they just weren't there anymore. Other things were. I needed to go back to that place again. I just needed a return trip to my childhood to pack up rubble memories to take with me before someone else occupied that space. I had to. I wanted Texas to be more familiar than it was when I went back. I wanted everything to reflect my memories exactly. It seemed like an eternity since I'd gone back to the mileposts and cairns of my past. But adults have slag lenses. And we all learned to breathe through filters. I wanted everything back the way it was. My granddaddy always told me I'd come back home looking for my porch, and here I was, looking. I just didn't want it to be too late. I had a cab pick me up from the church, and the cabbie asked me who got married, eyeballing my suit. Nobody, I said. As I rode in the taxi with that package next to me, I asked the driver to take a detour and stop on the farm road right outside my old junior high school. I just needed to see it again, to see if I could understand what I had missed. I told the driver that I'd only be a minute and asked him if I could leave my things in the back. I could see he was staring at me in the rearview mirror before he asked me. Nothing dangerous in that box, is there? I remember looking at it and wondering the same thing, but then I just stepped out of the cab and started down the long gravel driveway to the front of the school where it looped around and went right back out to the farm road. With every step I took, it grew and grew, until I found myself at its base, right in the center of that circular drive where kids are dropped off for school 180 days a year. There it was, the flagpole that gave me perspective, standing right where it left me. It wasn't until I was stranded up there in the middle of a dewy school night that I truly had a crystal clear picture of all the puzzle pieces that were to become my life. And with a mixture of trepidation and desire, I longed to climb it once more. To see it all again. You know, most memories have a sort of swelling effect. Just about everything from my youth that I see today is just a little bit smaller or less important than my memory scale. I now know of only two things that defy this rule: that flagpole and Jane. I knew exactly whose sneakers they were. Those Vans, the new and impossibly rare 95s, belonged to a unicorn. There was a 60-foot nautical-type flagpole dead center in the front of my new junior high school, and the sneakers dangled from the crossbar about 15 feet from the top. 2 weeks later, my granddaddy was asking my part in all of it, closing in on the truth because he knew I'd lied to my parents about the shoes up on the flagpole. He knew everything. The old, retired deputy sheriff sat on his rickety lawn chair on my front porch, staring out at the angry thunderhead accumulating on the Texas horizon, silently probing my truth. When he talked to me, he rarely ever looked me in the eyes. But when he did, it was something special. He was seeing something special. He was recognizing something in me. This time, his not looking me in the eye hurt a little bit, until it hurt more when he turned to me with gunmetal flinting out of his pupils, eyes that had drawn a confession from many a crook and lowlife. He said, "You can only ever assuage a mistake and benefit from it. You pull three lessons out of it." And even though my granddaddy's coon-ass Bayou French made fix come out as assuage, I knew exactly what he meant. I had to tell him the truth about the sneakers. When I arrived at school on the first day of sixth grade, I spotted her 95s through a cool wall of water gushing out of the furnace that was my Texas sky. Despite the blurring rain, I knew. I knew because every single day of that previous summer during swim team practice, I'd seen her walk by the pool. With a discerning eye that only adoration can bring, I watched her glide across the parking lot every day clutching a frisbee. So I knew, and I was immediately consumed with how I might get the 95s down and return them to their rightful owner. They were hers. She was the only person I knew with 95s, and they were almost as perfect as she was. "Who threw the clown shoes up onto the flagpole?" vibrated out of the speakers during the morning announcements. Our principal's voice paused for a moment afterward, as if Mr. Totter really expected an answer. I pictured him, his suit smelling of mothballs over the pilled-up gray wool vest, sticking his shiny head out of his office into the hallway awaiting an echoing confession. Obviously, one never came. So following a death-rattle cough, he finally concluded, "Lest you forget, this constitutes vandalism and will be treated as such. And no one defaces our wonderful school. And I will have those shoes down immediately." Minutes later, with a crowd of students around him on the front lawn, Mr. Totter was holding a pellet gun, patiently pumping it and firing it up at those shoes, trying to tear the laces and bring down those 95s like big game. The flagpole was a solid chrome monolith of 60 feet, over a foot in diameter at its base, and with two opposing arms jutting out from each side about 15 feet from the top, like a ship's mast. Both arms had a chrome ball at the end, and the sneakers were about 2 feet from the end of the right arm, swaying in the sultry breeze. I remember preparing to viciously tackle Mr. Totter to the ground if he would accidentally damage her shoes. I don't know if he realized his idiocy, or if he just gave up. But after a few more volleys, Mr. Totter scurried back into the building, gripping his rifle. All summer long, I had seen the flyers at the Piggly Wiggly for frisbee lessons at my junior high. So every day when I saw her pass the pool, I knew exactly where she was going. And every time I saw her pass again, going home, she would walk barefoot in the shallow creek that ran right next to the pool, letting her feet cool. Her 95s hung around her neck like a scarf, the same way I always wore the red scarf Mom made me for Halloween a few years earlier. Nothing changed the first half of her journey on that last day of summer, but on the way back, she just ran through the pool parking lot barefoot. I didn't see the 95s around her neck that evening, but I do remember that she did not stop to smile at me. Something had happened, and when I got to school that first day and saw those 95s dangling on the flagpole, my gut confirmed there was a new person on my hate list. Houston, Texas is about 1,700 miles from California, so things took a bit longer to arrive on our shores, and 95s were no different. I'd seen the icon Alva's feet in skateboard magazines, though, so I was well aware of the 95's hallowed significance. The fact that she not only knew what they were, but actually owned a pair was a testament to her unicornness. I would have staked my life on the fact that I was the only person in school who knew exactly what was dangling on that chrome cross in the schoolyard. Not just 95s, but 95s that her feet had graced. Those shoes weren't up there a week before someone drew a huge wanted poster on the bathroom wall. Missing. One pair of red and blue clown shoes. $500 reward. Signed, The Circus. Graffiti popped up everywhere referencing those shoes with various rewards. Each taunted me for the safe return of the 95s. The doggerel lit a fire under the school's ass, and there was rumbling that Mr. Totter had arranged to have the fire department come and extract the unpatriotic eyesore as soon as possible. Though the colors matched the flag. It didn't take long before rumors spread that Jonathan was the culprit. He was in eighth grade that year, and widely regarded, at least by me, as a complete jackwagon. One of those big-talking, verbal bullies who had never actually been in a fight in his life. His brown-bodied, white-billed John Deere hat had never left his head in all the years I knew him. Jonathan had stolen her shoes while she was playing frisbee barefoot on the field behind the gymnasium. Then, with the help of two of his idiot buddies, they slingshotted those sneakers up into the sky and onto that cross with the surgical tubing water balloon launcher. Jonathan even bragged that he had yelled to all the frisbee girls on the field until they each turned and stared at him, holding up the sneakers. Then saw a weird little hippie girl in a yellow dress, react, shot at the bird, and sprinted away with the stupidest looking shoes I'd ever seen on a girl. I was in the restroom one day after word had spread, and I even heard Jonathan changing his story to say that he actually climbed up there and hung them by hand. What a lion's sack of shit. I knew that fat fuck couldn't get 4 feet up that pole if his life depended on it. I just stood there at the urinal, pretending to pee, feeling the hatred rise up my entire body in a heat wave from my feet all the way into the root of every hair in my scalp. Jonathan had to pay. There was no way around it. Lion faggot tub of shit.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.